Mark chapter 1, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." I am standing in the Jordan River right now. This is where John the Baptist was baptizing people and preparing them, giving them a baptism of repentance, saying, "Do you understand who's about to come? Look, this is not just another human being that's going to show up." He really understood his unworthiness. And as I stared at that and I thought about this and the series we're doing, do you recognize how holy this is? I've been wrestling with this, thinking, God, who am I to even speak about God becoming flesh? And I can only imagine as he's coming, like, what do you do? What would it feel like to stand in front of your Creator? These are holy, holy, holy things. Man, it is so, so sad if you have lost the fascination of Almighty God emptying himself and taking the form of a man. God, I pray that as we pursue and we read this book together and we journey through the life of your Son, God, that we treat this as sacred, as holy, 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 like no other news on the earth, God. Change our hearts. Help us to see that everything else is so ridiculous compared to this one great truth of you becoming man, dying on a cross for all of our sins, rising from the dead. God, teach us how to marvel again. Teach us to be fascinated with the good news of Jesus Christ.
Watching online or you're here with us in person, we're really excited to worship our good God with you tonight. We are all sinners, right? We all have stuff that we bring to the table. And the thing about the gospel is that Jesus says, bring it all. He says, all of it, just bring it in front of me, bring it to the cross. So tonight, we're going to sing that everyone can come to the cross. Would you guys stand with us tonight?
Oh, Psalm 142, verse 1 says, I cry out to the Lord. I pray to the Lord for mercy. We know that we can talk to God because he listens. Our voices matter in heaven. He takes us very seriously. When we enter into his presence, he turns to hear our voices. There is no need to fear that we will not be heard, but that we would be ignored. Even if we stammer or stumble, even if what we have to say impresses no one, it impresses God, and he listens very intently, very carefully.
Father, we thank you for this night. We thank you for the service, everyone here tonight, that we can come together, and we can lift up your name, we can sing to you, we can glorify you. We pray, Father, that we be aware of your presence as we sing and as we go into your word tonight, and that we would draw closer to you, that we be aware of your spirit, and we would be obedient to follow the guidance that you would give us. And we thank you, Father, for this blessing, for this time. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
Much that I can't even handle it, you guys. But then he calls us to live in accordance with his will. And man, it's hard. Like, I feel like it's easy to make the decision to follow Jesus, and it's hard to live out the everyday of following Jesus. But here's the thing. He has given us the Bible to follow. He's given us the Holy Spirit to guide us. And we think that we should be seeing these like signs and be like, oh, this is what God wants for me and this is where he wants me to go. But the truth of the matter is, most of what he's teaching us is gonna come from reading our Bibles. It's gonna come from going to church. It's gonna come from being part of a small group. It's gonna come from praying to him. It's not usually going to be some big sign and wonder pointing you in a certain direction. So the next song we're gonna sing is about God showing us which way to go. And you guys have been here. Like literally a few weeks ago, I was praying and praying and praying for God to give me direction. And the truth of the matter is that direction is usually found in the Bible. So when you are seeking revelation from God, start with his written revelation to each of us.
Oh,
somewhere along the line, I started believing. I don't think I was taught this. I think it was just sort of, I don't know, some belief that I picked up, that if I was good enough, or the better I was, the more God would love me. And that could not be further from the truth. He loves us unconditionally, which means no matter what we do, he will not stop loving us. He cannot love us more, and he will not love us less. And you guys, that is such a beautiful truth, because that takes the pressure off of us, and it puts it back on him, which is where it belongs, because he is the author and perfecter of our faith, not us. This next song, in the bridge, it says, nothing can change the way that you love me. Nothing can change the way I belong to you. Yes, I do. Nothing can separate. Because the other part of the belief then was that when I did wrong things, things that went against what God wanted, he loved me less. I thought if I did better, he would love me more, and if I did worse, he would love me less. And you guys, that is just simply not the truth. The truth is, he loves us no matter what, and nothing and no one can separate us from the love of Christ.
Thank you.
Oscar is doing. I was going to take ask for volunteers if Oscar was going to stand up.
Is that better? Yeah, now it's turned on. That makes a difference. I'll scare myself. Oh. Well, I'll start over then. Before we retired, Carol and I attended a MetLife retirement planning class sponsored by her employer. When the presenter was asked direct questions, such as which is better, a Roth IRA or a conventional IRA, his typical response was, "It depends." In fact, the class was a little frustrating because the presenter, in response to almost every direct question that he was asked, replied, "It depends." And what he meant by that response was it depends on your current situation compared to your goals and plans for retirement. And since everyone's current situation, goals, and plans are different, the appropriate answer to our questions really was, "It depends." At the end of the class, however, he did schedule individual appointments where he provided answers to our direct questions, since he now knew what the answers depended on. Many of our questions in life may also be answered by "it depends," because what may be an appropriate response for me currently may change as my circumstances change. For example, as a younger man, I was willing to tackle many needed home repairs that I could perform myself to save some money. However, now that I'm older and physically less capable of performing a lot of these repairs, I will gladly pay someone else to perform the repairs for me. However, other questions in life may not be answered by "it depends." For example, Satan wants us to think that we can use "it depends" as an excuse for being disobedient to God's commands. However, we know God's commands are absolute, and we are expected to obey them regardless of our circumstances. So there are two questions we want to address in this sermon. First, is it ever appropriate to question or argue with God? And secondly, will I get punished for questioning or arguing with God? And of course, my answer to these questions is, it depends. And what does it depend on? Well, that is what we're going to investigate in the rest of this sermon. So let's start by looking at a familiar passage. In Genesis chapter 18, we see Abraham questioning God regarding the proposed destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. We will begin by reading verses 1 through 5 as background, and then jump down to verses 16 through 33, where Abraham is questioning God. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. When he saw them, he hurried from the entrance of his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. He said, "If I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, do not pass your servant by. Let a little water be brought, and then you may all wash your feet and rest under this tree. Let me get you something to eat so you can be refreshed and then go on your way, now that you have come to your servant." "Very well," they answered, "do as you say." We can't be certain that Abraham immediately recognized the three men he saw approaching as being divine beings, but obviously by the end of the visit he did. However, he did follow the customs of his day by providing them with hospitality and nourishment before they continued on their journey. When the men got up to leave, they looked down toward Sodom, and Abraham walked along with them to see them on their way. Then the Lord said, "Shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do? Abraham will surely become a great and powerful nation, and all nations on earth will be blessed through him, for I have chosen him, so that he will direct his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing what is right and just, so that the Lord will bring about for Abraham what he has promised him." Then the Lord said, "The outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is so great and their sin so grievous that I will go down and see if what they have done is as bad as the outcry that has reached me. If not, I will know." The men turned away and went toward Sodom, but Abraham remained standing before the Lord. Then Abraham approached him and said, "Will you sweep away the righteous with the wicked? What if there are 50 righteous people in the city? Will you really sweep it away and not spare the place for the sake of the 50 righteous people in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to kill the righteous with the wicked, treating the righteous and the wicked alike. Far be it from you. Will not the judge of all the earth do right?" The Lord said, "If I find 50 righteous people in the city of Sodom, I will spare the whole place for their sake." Then Abraham spoke up again. "Now that I have been so bold as to speak to the Lord, though I am nothing but dust and ashes, what if the number of the righteous is 5 less than 50? Will you destroy the whole city for lack of 5 people?" "If I find 45 there," he said, "I will not destroy it." Once again he spoke to him, "What if only 40 are found there?" He said, "For the sake of 40, I will not do it." Then he said, "May the Lord not be angry, but let me speak. What if only 30 can be found there?" He answered, "I will not do it if I find 30 there." Abraham said, "Now that I have been so bold as to speak to the Lord, what if only 20 can be found there?" He said, "For the sake of 20, I will not destroy it." Then he said, "May the Lord not be angry, but let me speak just once more. What if only 10 can be found there?" He answered, "For the sake of 10, I will not destroy it." When the Lord had finished speaking with Abraham, he left, and Abraham returned home. Well, there are many interesting things to be considered in this passage, but we will concentrate on the ones pertaining to questioning God. First, note Abraham's relationship with God. God has chosen Abraham to bless him and make him the father of many nations. Abraham has proven to be faithful and obedient to God in the past and promises to do so in the future. Notice also that Abraham's relationship with God is close enough that God wants to share with Abraham what he plans to do to Sodom and Gomorrah. God tells Abraham that Sodom and Gomorrah are wicked places that deserve to be destroyed because of their wickedness. Note also that the two men, which are later revealed as angels, continue on to Sodom while the Lord remains to talk with Abraham. Abraham has questions that he wants to ask the Lord, not because he questions God's wisdom or his authority to destroy the cities, but he wants to understand why God would do so. His real question concerns his understanding of the very nature of God. "Will you sweep away the righteous with the wicked?" Or in other words, "Will you not judge the righteous based on their own merit?" Notice also how Abraham approaches God with humbleness and reverence with phrases like, "Now that I have been so bold, though I am nothing but dust and ashes, may the Lord not be angry, and finally, let me speak just once more." It also appears by lowering the number gradually that Abraham, knowing what a wicked place Sodom was, is trying to determine if there's a limit to how many righteous people it would take to save it. Although Abraham stops asking at 10, I believe he is satisfied that God will not destroy a single righteous person with the wicked, thus reaffirming Abraham's understanding of God's character and holiness. So we see that Abraham questioned God to clarify his understanding of who God was. Now let's look at how and why the disciples questioned Jesus. Our first passage is found in Matthew 13, 10 through 17. The disciples came to him and asked, "Why do you speak to the people in parables?" He replied, "Because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, 'You will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. For truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it." In this passage, we see the disciples asking a question and learning that they were different from ordinary men because of their close personal relationship with Jesus. Their relationship and willingness to learn gave them better insight and understanding of what Jesus was telling them. But we know from other passages that they didn't always comprehend what Jesus was trying to teach them. For instance, in Matthew 18, 1-5. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" He called a little child to him and placed the child among them. And he said, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me." Well, this passage follows right after the disciples' discussion among themselves about which of them would be the greatest in heaven. Although we may consider this an inappropriate question to be asking Jesus, he answered them by providing an object lesson on humility. It is not the one who strives to be great in the kingdom of heaven who is the greatest, but the one who humbly serves. So we see that the disciples questioned Jesus to learn more about him and the kingdom of heaven. We know it is by asking questions that we learn and gain understanding. We also see that Jesus taught the disciples by asking them questions, which caused them to really think about their answers, as well as showing him how well they had grasped the lessons and concepts he was teaching them. One such question Jesus asked is found in Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 17. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elisha, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven." This question confirmed that the disciples understood who Jesus really was, and Jesus further reinforces that idea by his response to Peter. So what about the Jewish religious leaders? Why did they question Jesus? They were some of the blind and deaf that Jesus was talking about in the Matthew 13 passage. They wanted to catch or trick Jesus into saying something they could use against him, because he was a threat to their position and authority. We see a typical encounter described in Matthew 22, verses 23 through 33. That same day, the Sadducees, who say there is no resurrection, came to him with a question. "Teacher," they said, "Moses told us that if a man dies without having children, his brother must marry the widow and raise up offspring for him. Now there were seven brothers among us. The first one married and died, and since he had no children, he left his wife to his brother. The same thing happened to the second and third brother, right on down to the seventh. Finally, the woman died. Now then, at the resurrection, Whose wife will she be of the seven, since all of them were married to her? Jesus replied, You are in error because you do not know the scriptures or the power of God. At the resurrection, people will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They will be like the angels in heaven. But about the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what God said to you? I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. And when the crowds heard this, they were astonished at his teaching. I love this particular passage, especially verse 29, which says, Jesus replied, You are in error because you do not know the scriptures or the power of God. The Jewish leaders, who were supposed to be the experts in scripture, were called out for their lack of understanding. Then Jesus further addresses a question they didn't ask regarding the resurrection of the dead. He prefaces this answer with, Have you not read what God said to you? And then quotes scripture, which they should have known and understood. Obviously, this is not what they wanted to hear or expected to hear from Jesus. These Jewish leaders inappropriately questioned Jesus because they were not trying to learn from or grow closer to him, but instead were hoping to catch Jesus in an error they could use to discredit him. So when is it inappropriate for us to question Jesus? The simple answer is when we are questioning his commands or authority. We see this in the book of Jonah, when Jonah in his anger questions God's authority when God uses him to save his enemies from the destruction that Jonah wants them to suffer. We find this in Jonah chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. But to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? This is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you were a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it is better for me to die than to live. But the Lord replied, Is it right for you to be angry? What I find incredible about this passage is that Jonah was basically angry at God for being God. He knew God was gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, and abounding in love, but he didn't want God to be that forgiving, loving God to his enemies, the Assyrians. For them, he wanted God to be the mighty, avenging God who destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. And although Jonah didn't know it, God later would destroy Nineveh and the Assyrians, but only after they forsook their repentance and turned back to their evil ways. Unfortunately, I too have had a Jonah moment where I was angry with God and yelled at him for not blessing me with what I foolishly thought I deserved. I had only been a Christian for a few years and was graciously being blessed, so I assumed that meant I had earned God's favor. After all, I was a good Christian and was doing all the correct things, when suddenly God decided not to bless me in the way I thought he should. Instead of all my plans turning out as I had anticipated, door after door seemed to be slamming in my face, and I wasn't certain where my future was headed. Then one day while praying, I yelled at God in anger, accusing him of not loving me anymore since the blessings had appeared to stop. Like Jonah, God did not punish me for doubting him, but responded with, My son died for you. That answer hit me really hard, as I realized I wasn't following God, but trying to lead him, and that I was angry because he wasn't following me. I asked for and received his forgiveness, and like Jonah, God's grace later blessed me with those things he had temporarily withheld to get my attention so I would get my priorities straight. So if there are times that it is inappropriate to question Jesus, when is it appropriate to question Jesus, and how can we tell the difference? Well, the difference is not in the questions we ask, but our motive for asking them. We see throughout the Gospels that Jesus was a great teacher who spent most of his ministry teaching his disciples and the Jewish people about the kingdom of God. In the Gospel of John, we read about an encounter that Jesus had with another Jewish leader, a Pharisee named Nicodemus. John chapter 3, verses 1 through 5, tell us about this encounter. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. Jesus replied, Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born when they are old? Nicodemus asked. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Again, like we observed with Abraham, Nicodemus approaches Jesus with humbleness and reverence. He realizes that Jesus is blessed by God, but isn't sure who he really is. Nicodemus is further confused by Jesus' comment about being born again, so he asks questions for clarification. Jesus' answer tells him being born again is not another physical birth, but a different kind of birth, a spiritual birth that is necessary to enter the kingdom of God. This opens up another line of questioning, and their conversation continues on in chapter 3, down through verse 21. Nicodemus is asking questions because he wants to know and understand what Jesus is teaching, since his heart's desire was to grow closer to God. If we are seeking to know Jesus or better understand him and improve our relationship with him, then Jesus welcomes and encourages our questions. But notice that even when the questions were not from the heart and the negative examples given, that Jesus' answers are intended to correct the questioner's misunderstandings and are not intended as punishment. We do not receive punishment for questioning God. However, God does discipline us for being willfully disobedient to what we already know and understand. As we have seen, it is our heart condition and purpose in questioning Jesus that determines if our questions are appropriate or not. But how do we determine someone's heart condition if we do not ask questions? A friend of mine whose ministry is with college students told of an incident he once had with the president of one of the colleges where he ministered. The college president was recovering from a mild heart attack when my friend scheduled an appointment with him. He used this opportunity to ask him about his physical heart condition, and then as a follow-up question, inquired about his spiritual heart condition and if he had a personal relationship with Jesus. Although the president's answer was all about religion, it was obvious the real answer to the question, Do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? Was no. However, the president did reveal that he had a great respect for Christians. He admired all the good they did and their positive influence upon the campus. In other words, he had observed with his eyes but did not see, and listened with his ears but did not hear, because he failed to comprehend what he had seen and heard. How sad to come so close to having a personal relationship with Jesus and yet still refuse to accept him. So in conclusion, God encourages us to question or even argue with him when our desire is to know and understand him better, because that is how we grow. This is what it means to be a Christian, to live a life where we are continually growing in our knowledge and faith in our Lord Jesus. Don't ever be afraid to ask Jesus a question, because that is what he gave his life for, so he could have an intimate, personal relationship with you. So like my friend, let me ask you, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? If your answer is no and you would like to learn more, please come see me after the service or reach out to the pastor or one of our elders. And now would you join with me in prayer? Our dear and most gracious Heavenly Father, what a privilege we have in coming before your throne to meet with you, to know that you love us and want what is best for us, to know that we are your children, to know that we are holy in your sight because of Jesus' sacrifice of himself. Help us to be bold in asking you questions that will strengthen our faith, understanding, and relationship with you. Help us to be obedient to your commands and the things we understand while still trying to understand the things that have eluded us or that Satan has twisted to confuse us. Bless this time that we have spent worshiping together and help us as your children to live a life that glorifies your name. In Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen. And Mike Winter now, I think, has our communion meditation.
Hi. It's working. You can hear me? Everything's good? All right. As I was preparing for the community meditation today, and I was sharing this with folks this morning, and Ben usually gives us the dates we're going to do our meditation and months ahead of time. And through a series of trading things around and what have you, and then I ended up with today. And it hit me about 2 months ago that this is 20 years ago today, probably the worst thing that happened in our country's history and long, certainly in our generation, but with the attacks in September 11th. And I found myself struggling with what to say. It was the same struggle we had 20 years ago and a day. Rod and I sat in his office and kind of looked at each other and go, what, why has this happened? What, how do you make sense of this? How does a God that, how does God let this happen? And what we came up with was it's part of a plan that none of us understand. And we trust in God that it is his plan, and we move on. So with that in mind, I'm trying to think of what can I say that is meaningful in the time frame that we're talking about. And this is what I came up with. So hopefully you'll find meaning. Prior to the pandemic, there was a big push for in classrooms across the country about mentoring programs for kids to help them in school, whether it's reviewing a textbook, doing homework problems, or maybe just helping them focus a little. People are being asked to set an example, step up and lead, lend a hand in the best interest of our children. And while that covers the obstacles faced in the three R's, history, science, or the arts, there's still a lot left to learn. There are life skills that parents are expected to lovingly impart upon their children in a civilized world, all with the joy of parenting. Truth is, God expects all of us to be mentors. Step up and lead. Set an example. Why are we called to this? Because there's a lot at stake. In Isaiah, we learn the wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. Now, we can look at the symbolism from the Old Testament, try to figure out who's the wolf and all that. But after you get through all of that, the bottom line is pretty clear. That a little child will lead them. And we have the responsibility to teach them what they need to know. We all do. The psalmist writes, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter hidden things, things from of old. What we have heard and known, what our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from our children. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he's done. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our forefathers to teach their children, so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born. And they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. In the New Testament, we're called as Christians to teach, to mentor the children of God. Paul writes in the fourth chapter of 2 Timothy, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you, keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministry. In the 70s, Crosby, Stills, and Nash simply said, teach your children well and know they love you. Nearly 2,000 years earlier, Paul was a bit more specific. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and become convinced of, because you know from those from whom you have learned it. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may thoroughly be equipped for every good work. In our worship, we often raise up our hands to the Lord as he reaches out and picks us up. And we're comforted and encouraged by his Spirit around us. He loves us so much that he came to us as a child, taught us with great patience, endured hardship, and set an example for the world so that we could have everlasting life. Isn't it only right that we reach out to others to pick them up so that they might be thoroughly equipped for every good work? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to hear your word, to learn your ways, to follow your truth. Help us to be ever mindful of the sacrifice that was made so that we could learn and be saved, and ever willing to share with others the message of your love. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we continue to worship.
Is my Lord. Next week, be blessed.